Hey guys, Jake with 8020 Media here, bringing you a video today on the 6.7 liter Cummins turbo diesel engine. The 6.7 Cummins was launched midway through 2007 after Dodge retired the 5.9 liter 24 valve due to emissions regulations. A big change between the 5.9 and the 6.7 was a switch to a variable geometry turbo, which, as we'll cover later on, has been a rather problematic turbocharger for the 6.7 Cummins. Power production has varied from year to year, but the 6.7 Cummins was the first one to hit the 1,000 torque mark, and now for 2023 is producing 1,075 pound-feet of torque. The 6.7 Cummins is a little bit different from its competitors in the 6.7 Power Stroke and the 6.6 liter Duramax in that the Cummins is an inline six rather than a traditional V8 design. Now, throughout its nearly 15 years of production, it's gone through a number of revisions with a few changes in 2013 as well as in 2019. So we're going to do our best to distinguish the problems between the years and the different generations. However, there are a couple problems that are common across all of the different years and different generations of the engine. The first problem is with the DPF system, which is the diesel particulate filter. For 2007 and a half until 2012, the 6.7 Cummins didn't use DEF fluid because it didn't have an SCR system. Because it didn't use DEF fluid, it actually caused the engine to run a little bit more rich, which causes more soot buildup. And that combined with a bad regeneration strategy caused excessive buildup within the DPF system and ultimately would lead to a clogged DPF filter. Now, this is less common in 2013 plus models because SCR as well as DEF were added. However, you know, a clogged DPF is common across pretty much any modern diesel engine. And so while it is less common in 2013 plus models, it's not necessarily uncommon. When the DPF gets clogged, it typically causes a loss of power and it can send the car into low power mode. Due to the frequency of this problem, it's really common to see owners deleting the DPF system as well as the EGR system. However, we won't go into that since that is something that's illegal to do and the EPA is starting to crack down on. So while that is a common option, we're going to go ahead and leave it at that. The second most common problem is with the turbocharger. Earlier model 6.7s are most prone to this. There are a couple different things that plague the turbocharger, and that's leaking oil seals, worn bearings, sticking VGT components, as well as compressor or turbine wheel damage. So overall, the turbochargers on the 6.7 Cummins tend to be rather problematic. With that being said, you typically don't see problems until after the 100 to 125,000 mile mark. And so they tend to be relatively reliable up until that point. Again, this is most common on the earlier models, but turbochargers are extremely high stress components. On the 6.7, the turbine wheel can spin at over 100,000 RPMs. And so there's just a lot of stress that are put on these components, which is why it tends to fail as frequently as it does. With that being said, whenever it does fail, one of the common things to do is to put a larger turbocharger in it. By putting a larger turbocharger in there and running it at kind of stock power levels, you're essentially reducing stress on the turbo and requiring it to not work as hard, which can increase the reliability of it. And so if it does fail, we'd recommend looking into some OEM plus type replacements for it. A third common problem is head gasket failure. And now we don't believe that this is necessarily as common as it's been made out to be on the internet, but the head gasket does fail a lot more frequently than it does on the 5.9 Cummins, which is why this makes our list. When you look at the 6.7, especially the newer ones, they're producing over 1,000 feet pound of torque. And, you know, the cylinders operate under very high pressures, which can lead to head gasket failure. The most telltale symptom of head gasket failure is a white smoke coming out of the exhaust, and it typically has like a sweet smell to it. You'll also might notice oil mixed with coolant or coolant mixed with oil, and you'll typically see a lot of overheating when you do have head gasket failure as well. There are some kits that prevent this. You can go ahead and use a heavier duty gasket as well as ARP head studs. However, this kit or kits like this typically cost about $1,800 to $2,000. And so using a kit like that's most common if your head gasket has already failed or if you're modifying the 6.7 to produce a good bit more power than stock. A gasket itself is pretty inexpensive, so the majority of the cost to repair this is labor. And so you're looking at about $1,000 to $1,500 to fix this issue. If you want to go ahead and put an upgraded head gasket kit on it and use upgraded studs, you're probably looking at the $3,000 to $3,500 mark. And so something to be aware of that preventing this issue from happening again is relatively expensive. A fourth problem is with fuel dilution. So the 6.7 Cummins doesn't use a seventh fuel injector to inject fuel into the exhaust stream for DPF and regeneration cycles. Because it doesn't use a seventh injector, it can cause some fuel to stick to the cylinder walls as it's sprayed out during the exhaust stroke. And this can cause it to mix with oil, which essentially causes dilution within the oil and can lead to excessive wear on the internal components of the engine. Dodge claims that 5% dilution is within normal ranges. However, the 6.7s are known to experience a little bit of excess dilution. And so it is a good idea to get an oil analysis done on your 6.7 from time to time, just to make sure you're keeping it within a normal level of dilution. Otherwise, it can lead to a lot of additional wear on internal components and cause the engine to fail more quickly than it would otherwise. There are some ways to prevent this. One is by letting your engine warm up before you do any heavy driving with it or heavy towing. And then another is to prevent excessive idling. The fifth common problem on the 6.7 Cummins is with the emission systems as well, and more specifically with the EGR cooler. EGR cooler failure is extremely common across every modern diesel engine out there, including the Ford and the GM engines as well. And so this is a common problem. It can be somewhat expensive to replace. That being said, if you're looking at choosing the 6.7 Cummins over the Powerstroke or the Duramax, those engines as well suffer from EGR issues, DPF issues, and so on. And so this is a common problem, but it's common across all diesel engines. Like I mentioned with the DPF system, it's common to delete that system. Usually when you delete the DPF system, you also delete EGR as well, which prevents any issues with the EGR cooler failing. And so that is a common route to go just due to how common of a problem it is to have EGR related issues, DPF, SCR, and DEF related issues with the 6.7 Cummins. So that wraps it up with our video on common problems with the 6.7. Overall, we give it an average reliability rating. The majority of the issues with it are with the emission systems or stem from the emission systems. And like I continue to say, you know, this isn't unforeseen in the other engines out there. So this engine is certainly less reliable than the 5.9 and the other kind of pre-emissions diesels, but it's probably, you know, average for the diesels being produced today. I know everyone tends to have a preference between GM and Ford and Dodge. I drive a Ford, but if you ask me right now who's producing the best diesel engine on the market, it would probably be the Duramax L5P. Now, before people come for my head in the comments on that one, that engine as well does have a number of common problems with it, which we discussed in a separate video, but that's just my opinion on what I think the strongest engine in the market is right now. The 6.7 Cummins still should be good to last 250,000 plus miles with proper maintenance. And so don't get me wrong, there are plenty of very reliable 6.7s out there. I would just note that the general theme is that the newer engines are more reliable than the older engines. And so if you're looking at some of the earlier model 6.7s, especially ones that are high mileage, just know that you might run into some issues with turbocharger, head gasket, and the emissions systems. So generally speaking, newer is better, newer is more reliable, but these problems do tend to plague the majority of the 6.7s out there. Anyways, guys, that's all we've got for this video. As you can tell, our table continues to get filled up with a bunch of different parts here as the rest of our turbo kit came in for the 135. And so one of the next up videos will be the start of our build series for this car right behind me. So give us a subscribe, like this video, and stay tuned for future videos.